Hello, my name's Greg. I'm an assistant editor at Chatto & Windus, which is part of Penguin Random House. And I am going to be talking to you a bit about The Last Samurai by Helen DeWitt. And this is a book that was published originally in 2000 to kind of outstanding reviews across the board. It sold in excess of 100,000 copies. It was nominated for several prizes. But then by some kind of horrible twist of fate, it fell out of print. And I should say at this point as well, this has nothing to do with the Tom Cruise film that came out in 2003. They are very, very different things. So I first became aware of the book about 2 years ago, in 2016, when a small but quite brilliant press in the States called New Directions decided to reissue the book. And someone put it on my desk and said, "Greg, you know, you should really think about reading this. Like, it's, you know, it looks incredible." And I confess at that point I was pretty intimidated by it because it had a little flick through and it's got all these different languages in, it's got equations, it's got rows and rows of numbers, and it took me a while to get to it. But the reason I did was because all of these amazing reviews started coming in, people saying that the book was a kind of masterpiece and that nothing had occurred in fiction before or since, the author was a genius, etc, etc. And eventually I got round to actually reading the thing. But I should also say that when the book was out of print, it acquired this kind of cult-like status where very few people could get hold of it. More or less no bookshop stocked it. If you wanted to actually get a copy, you would have to ask the publisher to kind of print a copy especially for you. And it kind of passed into kind of literary like folklore. It was very kind of under the radar. And so the plot of the book runs something like this. So we begin with Sybilla, who is this young American woman studying at Oxford on a scholarship, but then she decides to kind of to drop out of Oxford because she finds her studies too narrowing, too kind of constricting, and the kind of ultra specialization just not to her taste. So she quits Oxford, moves to London, gets a job as a typist at a small publishing house, and kind of takes on various odd jobs and kind of begins this relatively precarious life living in London. And then she has this drunken one-night stand with this travel writer who kind of trades in kind of slick sounding sentences and speeches which have all the kind of outward appearance of profundity but are actually incredibly banal, incredibly dull, and he's kind of a moron, kind of embarrassing. And the result of that one-night stand is her son Ludo. And then the first part of the book is really about seeing Ludo's education. So he doesn't go to school. She decides to teach him, begin to teach him how to read from the age of two. Then they go on to Latin and Greek, and then Arabic and Hebrew and Japanese, and then mathematics and then aerodynamics. And these things kind of go one after the other, and he just picks them up. And the whole book is really kind of about cultivating that kind of ambition in the reader. So it's kind of making you think, you know, if it's so easy for this young boy, this fictional boy, how hard can it be? And you see him learning these things on the page. And so it really makes you think that actually, you know, you can do this, anyone could do this. And so one way to read the book, one interpretation of the book maybe, is that it's a kind of scathing indictment of the Western system of education. So and also the culture that we live in where learning of this kind isn't really valued. Like, it was published in 2000, but what it was saying then about education is probably even truer now with the kind of increased marketization of education, the kind of monetization of learning, these kind of things. And the central notion of the book really, I think, is about this idea that most people never really reach their potential, they never realize their potential because they're mired in this culture that tells them that some things are just too hard, some things are just too difficult, so you shouldn't even try. And this whole book is really a repudiation of all that, and kind of saying what the world might be like if, you know, you were encouraged to try these things, if you were encouraged to try to learn these new subjects. And then in the second half of the book, Ludo's kind of curious, insistent, slightly obnoxious voice begins to take over, and so his mother, Sybilla, won't tell him who his father is. So he thinks, right, I'm going to go out into London and I'm going to find who my actual father is. And so the book kind of asks the question, if your actual biological parent is a horrible disappointment, what would it be like to go and to go into the world and to find, or rather to choose, your new father, so you can present yourself as your son before them and then kind of test them and see if they're a decent parent for you. And this kind of goes on. There's a structure lifted from this film called Seven Samurai, by directed by Kurosawa, and the rest of the book is kind of Ludo working out who his father should be. And I just want to say one final thing about the style of the book and the kind of reading experience. So as I said before, there's kind of very irregular type. There are the fonts kind of vary drastically from each other. There's about a dozen different languages. There's lots of numbers. But it's all incredibly accessible. And this is one of the things about Helen DeWitt, is that she's able to write about these very seemingly highbrow things and very difficult things in a very, very chatty, colloquial, simple, accessible way, just like David Foster Wallace did very well. And it's also incredibly funny. Like, there's this caustic, kind of acerbic wit running throughout the entire book, and it is in parts just hilarious. It's a fun read. It's a yarn as well as being like a very clever book. Okay, so this is what the book used to look like when it was first published in 2000. But this is not the one that you'll be seeing in shops. This is our new edition here. We are reissuing it in March. I hope you enjoyed watching. We are very proud to be putting this back into print, so I hope you pick up a copy.